Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
This time I call the meeting to order, and I'll ask Mr. Engel, please, to give the invocation.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the many bountiful blessings that you bestow on us each day. And as we come to you now, Lord, I do lift up the following to you in prayer. Lord, we pray now for Commissioner Vaughn and her family as they continue to mourn the loss of her mom. Lord, I pray for Governor Scott's family. And Lord, we just thank you for Governor Scott and just what he meant for this county and this state and his service. Lord, I do pray for Clyde Albright's mom. Lord, pray that you'd be with him and her, Lord, and we just pray for her health as well as Jim Long, Lord. We pray for him and his health. Lord, we pray that you'd be with this board tonight as we attend to the business of those that we serve. And Lord, may we endeavor to help improve the quality of life of those that we serve. Father, be with our men and women overseas as they stand in harm's way. Keep them safe, Lord. Place that mighty veil of safety over them. Bring them home to us safely. These things, Lord, I do pray in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Before we start the public comments, I will ask you to keep your comments 3 minutes or less so everybody will get a chance, because we have right many on here tonight. And you will hear a buzzer go off at 3 minutes, so if you would please adhere to that and just do 3 minutes or less, okay? And at this time, I'll start with Gina Squires, who is the first one.
Hello, Commissioner. Thank you, Gina. I'm Gina Squires. I'm Ralph Squires' sister. And when Ralph built this track, he built it for his little grandson, Christopher, to ride his four-wheeler. And it's kind of like Field of Dreams. Build it and they will come. That's what happened. And I think it shows how starved some of the people in Alamance County are for a place to go for recreation on Sunday afternoon, just to have clean, good backyard fun. And if there is anything that you could do to get Ralph legal so he could continue running his little track, then I know that there are people all over Alamance County who would be very grateful to you. Thank you.
Thank you,
Ms. Squire. Appreciate it.
I call her Gina because I've been knowing her a long time. Okay, the next is Amy Scoggins.
Congratulations, Linda.
Thank you.
Hey, Amy. Back. And
how are you?
Dan.
Thank you.
I'd like to say thank you to Mr. Ray Cobb, Jr. and Jay Burke for the work that they have done for Alamance County. I know Jay very well. Worked with him on quite a few transactions. Have nothing but the utmost respect for him. However, I am a firm believer in term limits. I feel that every elected official from the local level all the way up to the federal level should be limited to terms. This allows for new thinking, more innovational thinking, gives more citizens the opportunity to serve, and that's what we need. If we start changing the rules, we start making exceptions now. Every time we turn around, somebody's going to want to make an exception here, change a rule here. It's kind of like raising our kids. You know, you make one exception to them, a couple of weeks later they come back and they want another exception, and then another one. Then you have to question, well, who's ruling the roost here, me or him? So I just think that we need to stick with our term limits, get some new way of thinking in, and I'm asking you guys to vote down this change of the exception to the rule again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Henry Vines.
Good evening, Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity of y'all letting me come, tonight I would like to address a problem that has arose over the last couple of weeks, and this is on business personal property listings. I know that most all of y'all are aware of this because I've talked to most of you. I first would like to thank Kim Horton for the excellent job that she done presenting these workshops. It was a thing that it was really needed that she worked with us on the Farm Bureau as well as with the Ag Extension Office. We had a close to 120 people attend these two meetings. Both meetings were filled. And I'd like to thank Commissioner Boswell for attending that one meeting. I know that y'all were in meeting today and were unable to meet with this one. I will tell you that this was, for the ones of you who weren't there, there was some very contentious meeting at times, and it was very informative. This meeting was conducted to make farmers aware of what they should be listing. There is audits being done, which is always should have been done, but has not been done in the past. I think this is what's caused the problem, because we haven't abided by the laws that are on the books, which says we're supposed to do these audits 1/8 out of every 8 years. Everyone would have received an audit. Therefore, in 1985, when this listing stopped, some people, farmers and business people, I don't know for sure on the business side, but I'm speaking for farmers, come out with the conception that they didn't have to list their business property. Their farms is business property. Well, as this went on, what has happened is we have got a large group of people out here that have not listed their property taxes because they thought that their property taxes were listed under business, under their personal property. And in some cases, such as myself, weren't listing some things that we were required to list, but by misinformed, were not listed. These being supplies and fuels and such as this. I would like to ask y'all tonight if y'all would consider putting in some kind of a referendum or a resolution that would maybe defer these penalties or even these taxes and let people come forward and get their tax listings corrected. I ask this because I feel like it's going to put a hardship on a lot of people that can't afford to do this, and I know my time's out. I would also like to comment on the other, on the public hearing when you come with it. But I would like to say to commissioners that we, the Farm Bureau, farmers out here would be glad to work on a commission that would come up with a solution, an idea that would be equitable to everyone. And I would appreciate y'all's consideration on this and studying on this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Tony Cox.
How y'all doing?
Yeah.
Good.
This is about when I was put out of business. Ray Cobb, at the planning board meeting, you knew I was in business before the ordinance, correct?
Mr. Cox, I don't think you can ask him questions in here. Clyde, is that right?
He can comment, but I don't think he can question.
Yeah, I don't think you can question Ray in here. Not in this, because this is just for public comment, okay?
How do we get it back on the, how do we redress it?
What I've told you is that you and I will sit down with Mr. Albright,
mm-hmm.
okay, and we will talk about it and see what he needs. Is that all right with you?
And that was 3 weeks ago.
Yeah. But
in the
whenever
Ray
you...
Ray Cobb could answer these questions now to...
I'm sorry?
Ray could answer these questions now to show...
Not here tonight, no. Because this is just for public comment, okay?
So I get the death sentence and...
No, you and I, if you will get with me, we will meet with...
I did.
I understand, but you didn't tell me when you wanted it, okay?
You said you had my number, you called.
I got your number. Okay. And I have been sick, and I apologize. Will you please set up an appointment?
Can we have Ray Cobb there, too?
I have no power to force Mr. Cobb to go to any meeting.
Yeah. I'll be there.
Okay. And I will meet with you. I will let you know, and I do have your number. So I will let you know, and we will let you know, too, when we're going to meet, okay, with the county attorney. Okay? Is that okay?
Well, it also comes to this other deal with the, keeping people after their deal. I think this is going to go to moral turpitude.
Well, let's go with and talk to Mr. Albright, and I'll be there, okay? All right. Bill Smith.
I'm Bill Smith, and I'm here on the go-kart track situation.
Okay.
And I would really appreciate it if y'all would kind of help us out a little bit on this ordinance deal with that. It looks like it's penalizing us for a place we want to have to play with. You know, just to play on Sunday. And that's kind of give us a little help if you can. I sure would appreciate it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Eric Richardson. Oh, okay.
They have me in the overflow.
Oh, okay. I'm glad you could hear it over there.
Chairman Massey, Commissioner Vaughn, gentlemen. For a change, it's nice to appear before y'all with some more good news. Several things. First, Civil War Trails is coming the end of February to check all our sites. They should be installed by mid-June. So that should all be taken care of. Second, we're working on the Historic Properties Commission on the courthouse renovation. And we'll be coming to y'all asking for some input from the commissioners soon. We heard from the architects. And finally, in planning a couple of months ago, I brought up the issue of a dark skies initiative and spoke to Commissioner Vaughn about this. And Commissioner Vaughn's question to me was, what does planning say that would cost us?
This is about what? I'm sorry.
It's a dark skies initiative. We have the Three Colleges Observatory down in Snow Camp on the mountain. It's about a half a mile from the house. Mm-hmm. When I moved to Alamance County about 21 years ago, you could see the Milky Way when you come home at night about 7:30 at night this time of year. Unless it's a real cold, clear night now, you can't see it. And it's light pollution coming from what's now Canfor. Used to be Sizemore. But since they've cleaned that up and expanded it, a lot more light. I talked to Christopher today, and Commissioner Vaughn, he said there shouldn't be any cost at all. This is a voluntary initiative. And so what we've done, we've looked at Albemarle County, Virginia, and Albuquerque, New Mexico, both of whom did voluntary, went to the businesses and said, look, you save money. And the businesses implemented it. All we would probably need is for y'all to ask the DOT to turn the lights down on the interstate, because they've been turning it off because of the budget issues. Mm-hmm. You should see how much better the sky is because the DOT's out of money.
Oh, okay.
And I think that's all. Oh. And one thing, Commissioner Sutton, you talked last time I appeared about the war memorial. And I'm taking a public history class, and we've looked at the balance of that memorial, because the Civil War side's about 50% blood. How would you go about balancing that as a public space? So should come back to you with some ideas on how to
Forgive me, which war memorial?
The one right here in front of the courthouse.
Oh, the Civil War. Yeah.
Because you asked me, you said, what's the count? About 330. Should be somewhere close to 480.
Oh, people that were killed.
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
So if
a long time.
Right. If you plant a seed, sometimes seed takes a year or so to grow. Sometimes it takes a little while to sprout. With me, especially.
We need to get the gun back in his hand.
Well, you take that up with the UDC. I'm not messing with the UDC myself. But we're looking at how that public space would look, Mr. Sutton. So I want to come back to you with an idea on that. So
we'll talk.
That's a seed that you planted that didn't die. I'd like to thank y'all for y'all's time.
Thank you. Mr. Childers?
Childers.
Childers.
I think he's in
the other room.
Okay. I guess it's Peter.
Is it the gun or the bayonet that's out of his hand?
Peter Childers.
Which one is it?
Peter Childers.
It's the gun? That's what I thought. Gotta have a gun.
Thank you. I'm assuming that I'll have a chance to speak at the planning board ordinance as well as here?
Yes. Okay. We just ask that you keep it 3 minutes.
Sure. Great. Well, this is one page.
Okay.
Or less.
Good deal. Thank you.
3 minutes.
Thank you, Peter.
Anyway. So this is concerning the drag strip racetrack
yes, sir.
Amendment considerations.
And I'd like to say that I think commissioners should consider very carefully before creating a possible loophole in the ordinance that will, in effect, allow de facto drag strips or racetracks to evolve, which in time could be converted to commercial businesses as a way around the existing ordinance. Try taking it away once it is established and grandfathered. The surrounding community's considerations for this type of land use are no different for a supposed non-commercial enterprise. There is no way the county can police whether or not payment is being collected, either directly or through hidden voluntary donations to skirt the ordinance requirements. The traffic, noise, pollution, and aesthetic implications will impact neighborhoods, property values, and saleability whether or not money is exchanged. It is one thing for a property owner to provide a place for their children and a few friends to ride motorized vehicles, and quite another to build a community access racetrack with all the amenities. I would also caution commissioners about legalizing a quasi-commercial activity where the landowner puts invited users at potential risk, but for which he holds no liability insurance to protect patrons. If there is ample community support for this type of land use, then let the racing community abide by the ordinance and invest in a proper commercial establishment within the requirements of the ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I give this to the record? Is that?
You can. That will take that.
Thanks. You.
Penny Gross. She in the other room. Penny Gross. Y'all okay in there? You guys okay in there?
Yeah. Good. I'm here about the mobile home appeal. Really, I sent in a appeal on it saying as to why I don't feel like I should have to be held responsible for cleaning that up, because I haven't lived in that place for 11 years.
Yeah.
And yeah, even though my name's on the deed, you know, my brother's name's on there too. And I mean, you know, they're in the next room, so anything that's ever come about all this, it's always come to me. It always has. You know, they've always found me. And, you know, I mean, I really don't, I've never had to, you know, do anything like this before. You know, I wasn't the one who pulled that mobile home out there and set it up like that. You know, I mean, they don't even own the land anymore. And, you know, they came to me saying, well, you know, we think we're going to hold you a third responsible for cleaning this up. But the way I feel about that is, I mean, I haven't lived there in 11 years. I've never had any say-so over that land, period. You know, I mean, been moved out, gone, have a son of my own, you know, married and all that. And it's, you know, they borrowed money against.
You are on our agenda. Do you want to wait and come back when?
Yeah, that
it would be better if you did, because you've only got 3 minutes right here.
Well, actually, really, I can just sum it up, you know, and I'm
okay, because I mean, we'll be glad you are on our agenda.
Yeah, if I need to come back, okay. I can. I mean, pretty much what it all sums down to is I don't think I should have to, you know, be held responsible for this, because I've never had no say so's on anything that ever happened to the land anyway. Whenever they borrowed the money from beneficial about it, well, my name was on it, and I didn't have no say-sos if they got to borrow that money, and I didn't get any from it. So, I mean, I just don't think I should be held responsible. But that's left up to y'all.
And if you'll please stay and come back when we get to that.
Okay.
Thank you, Ms. Griffin.
Mm-hmm. It's under Cox. It's under Cox. We got to share that. I didn't understand. Beverly Kerr or Carr?
She's in the room also, I think.
Beverly Kerr. Hmm. Hey, Beverly. How are you?
I'd like to thank you for letting us come and speak tonight about our concerns about the planning board. We understand from the planning ordinance that our planning board is directed to set up a program of public meetings in order to encourage public participation and expression and a better understanding of the needs of the county. I took that right from the ordinance. With that in mind, we have several requests. We would like to see our planning board website include current listing of meeting informations, including date, time, location, and agenda, current member information, current openings on the board, qualifications for openings, and instructions on how to apply for the positions. I'm just not sure that most people know what's available or how to go about getting involved in it. We understand that revisions are made but are not always reflected in the ordinance, so we request that this ordinance be kept current at all times. We understand that members who miss two consecutive meetings are not being removed as directed by the ordinance. In fact, we are told that some members have missed many meetings and no action has been taken. Our main concern is that we're not aware of efforts being made to find replacements for outgoing members. We would like to see specific instructions in the ordinance on how replacements are to be recruited. We know that there are citizens who want to be involved in the planning board, and we hope you will give them an opportunity to serve the county. I'm a little bit confused about this next thing, and I wasn't even sure whether to bring it up, but I just want to say that this is confusing to me. So we would like more information about changes that are being proposed to allow seniority on the board rather than township. Determine who will serve as a regular voting member. Will this make the planning board more widely representative of the county as is directed in the current ordinance? Thank you for taking the time to hear our concerns and for helping us to understand all of these issues.
And we'll let Jason answer that at the public hearing.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Christian Stahlberg.
Good evening. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here tonight.
Okay.
My comments this evening are in regards to the proposed changes for the Planning Board of the Alamance County. If there's any lesson to be learned from the economic meltdown and the greed, graft, and corruption inside Wall Street and the Beltway, it's that we're on our own. We're on our own with respect to food supply, our energy, and our livelihood. Urban and regional planning with sustainability at its core is what we need. We need fresh blood, new ideas, and expertise and vision throughout local government with self-sufficiency as the goal. This is especially true for the planning board. It's my understanding that approximately half of the current planning board members are either a contractor, a realtor, or a developer, or in the construction industry. I submit to you that there's a very good likelihood that a lot of these individuals do not even understand the principles of sustainability and what's going to be required of us going forward into the future, so as to not have the vulnerability that we currently experience with our dependency upon highly centralized and highly vulnerable systems of energy, which also drives our food stock. So I would ask that you take the time to come up with new and innovative ways to solicit new members for the planning board so as to work on these issues. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Michael Holland. Michael in the other room?
Yeah.
Michael Holland. Here's Mr. Michael. Hey, Michael, how are you?
I'm fine. Good. Very glad to see you have the chair position. Congratulations, Chairman, and to the rest of you for your re-election and election. I've come to speak about the planning board issue.
Okay.
And I know I'm out of turn and there's no coming, but I've got my daughter here and I need to get on home.
Okay.
I wanted to support term limits. So that's the short end.
Mike, hold on just a minute. Can you hear him in the back? Can you either talk louder? Because your voice goes this way.
Okay. Is this better?
Just pull it up. Pull it
closer, Doctor. There you go.
I was watching Christian talk, and it was like a...
Yeah, she talks loud, so...
Madam Chair, the microphones, they don't amplify it here, therefore the actual recording system. So
okay.
They speak into the microphone, it's not going to make any louder in the back.
So they probably just have to talk louder.
I understand. Louder. Certainly.
There you go.
I want to support term limits.
There you go.
Right there. That's a good one.
I'd like to support B. Holt's idea, staggering the appointment. Seems like a very reasonable approach. In terms of my reasoning, I think since half the board or over half the board are in the construction industry, there are developers, contractors, there's a backhoe operation owner, realtors, and my mother was retired and became a realtor, and my father was a general contractor. So I have a great deal of love for those industries, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with the construction industry. I'm just saying that in terms of moving forward with sustainable development in this county, I think it's important to have diversity on the planning board. And it appears that the current situation has put us into a very fast growth situation across the county, and that I think can be remedied by bringing in more public participation on the planning board and continuing to have a diverse planning board, which staggered appointments would help. On the second note, in regards to the issue of the go-kart track, which I grew up driving around as a kid, I can't speak to one way or the other. I shouldn't, because it's not my topic. However, there is $300,000 of federal money a year coming into the state. The trails director for the state, who's helped us out on the Haw River Trail,
right,
has given us $200,000 in grants just for our little county alone.
Mm-hmm.
Real excited about this gentleman. Darryl McBain has got a third of $1 million a year to spend on an ATV park. And I'd love to come back and talk to our wonderful parks director, Brian Hague. Can't say enough about that gentleman. To find a home for that federal money in Alamance County and develop an ATV park to send our kids someplace to ride responsibly and
good.
Get a little education at the same time. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Michael.
Have a good new year.
Mm-hmm. Appreciate it.
Okay. Pat Dodson. Hello.
Good evening, Madam Chairman, mm-hmm. Commissioners. I'm Pat Dodson. I have very brief comments on the planning ordinance. I support the ordinance as it stands. The current ordinance allows for representations from many areas of the county with set term limits. I'm a firm believer also in set term limits. This allows the opportunity for new folks to participate in boards and bring new ideas, and with that comes possibly new, more creative solutions to the problems that our counties are facing. I do ask that the county put in place a process that lets the folks in the county know when there are vacancies on this board and how we could apply for those. I thank you for your consideration.
And we will let Mr. Let Jason address that when he comes up for the public hearing. Okay, that's the last person that signed up. Is there anybody else who wants to say anything? If not, I'll close the public comments at this time, and we'll go back to. Oh, I do.
Got a volunteer.
Say, Robert.
Good evening. How are you?
Good.
Robert Rhodes.
I'm interested in talking about the tax issue on the property tax.
Mm-hmm.
I've attended the meeting that we had, and it's not just going to affect the farmers. It's going to affect all small business people. It doesn't matter if it's a landscaper, a farmer, a restaurant owner, someone in the construction business. So I think that I would like to ask the county commissioners to look at the situation. Look at how many people this could possibly put out of business. For people that didn't even know they was doing wrong. A good example was, I had no idea that you were supposed to pay tax on diesel fuel that you had on your farm. No earthly idea. But if they go back, you take a restaurant that lump summed whatever it cost them to go into business and pay the taxes on it, but then the county comes in and says, well, you didn't pay it on this. You got to have this stuff separated. And if they come go back 5 years and expect you to pay the taxes for 5 years back that you was already paying taxes to start with because you lumped it together, it's going to put people out of business. And I think it's time that we try to start generating business instead of putting people out of business with the economy like it is. And it's going to be devastating to this county if every business in Alamance County has to go back 5 years and pay tax on something that they've already paid it on. So I would like to ask the commissioners to maybe come up with something to where we can start from 2009 and go forward. 2008's gone. The county made its budget, evidently. So let's not put somebody out of work. Let's promote work. That's what the economy needs now is people working, making money. If they're making money, they're putting money into the economy. If you take those small businesses and put them out of business, what have you gained? You've actually lost tax revenue instead of gaining tax revenue. And I'd like to thank y'all for your time and hope y'all will keep that in consideration.
Thank you, Robert.
Appreciate it, Robert.
Okay. At this time, I will close the public comments. And we will go to the public hearing. And Mr. Jason, if you will come up, Mr. Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. If I may, with your permission, start by just addressing some of the public comments that were brought out. I would like to do that if that's okay. First, I heard several people make the suggestion of improving the planning board's website to include information regarding the roster of the planning board, also to have updated agenda information, meeting information, minutes, that sort of thing, and also to advertise when there are public positions on the board open. All of those are very reasonable requests, and I'm very open to that. Also, as I said at the last meeting, we're in the process of going through some website changes, and that will be at the top. It is at the top of my agenda is to rework the department's website, just in general. I think in terms of planning board members, I think there should be some care and caution given to how we put that information on the board. If we want to put who it is and what township they represent, that's fine. Those are bridges that I can cross at that time. But I just wanted to say that I think that's a reasonable request, and I'm very open to that. And I do have to just at one more time in a public forum, I would like to address the issue of regarding developers and contractors and builders on the board. That may very well have been the case at one time. It is not the case now. There is not a majority of builders or contractors. And I'm speaking of the board prior to December 31st. At that time, there was maybe a third of the board or 40% of the board that was tied in some way to the construction industry or the development industry. There has been a big change and shift in diversity on the board. We have a banker on the board. We have an accountant on the board. We have Jane Isley, who is very well known as a farmer on the board. Steve Love is a farmer. The agricultural industry is very well represented on the board, and that's something that personally I'm very proud of, is the fact that we do have that diversity. And I do want to say that the fact that somebody is a contractor, a developer, or a realtor, or something in that industry is not necessarily a bad thing. Those are the people that are affected the most by planning decisions. They have to work within the regulations, and so their input is critical. And so I just wanted to address that issue again in a public forum. I hear these comments quite a bit, and I bite my tongue quite a bit. I just wanted to take the time to express those concerns tonight. On to the public hearing and ordinance amendments at hand. One thing I did put before you tonight, before the meeting, is a list. We did some research, and I apologize that it did not get into your packets in time. We did not find out our final data until today, actually, from Randolph County. But I asked Christopher to do some research. I wanted to find out specifically, other than hearing through the grapevine, how other counties handle their planning board, how many members they have, the terms, the term limits, do they even have term limits, and the number of townships that they have. And one of the issues that had been brought up before was the issue of at-large positions, which in a situation where there is a requirement for every township to have one person represent them, then in that case an at-large, an additional at-large position would be logical in that case. And then a good example would be the Chatham County example, where they have 11 members and one at-large person that is a non-voting member. But the catch is, in Chatham County, the commissioner that is elected actually appoints that individual to the planning board. And so they stay on the planning board until the commissioner loses or retires or whatever. And then there is that one at-large position that's appointed, I presume, by the board as a whole. So that's one example, and the reason why I gave the number of townships here is to give the correlation between the number of townships and the number of members. You'll see all of these, the number of members are not the total number of townships. Even in the case of Chatham County, it doesn't represent the whole, every township's not represented. And that is the case in Alamance County as well, though we're pretty close. I believe we have 9 of the 13 townships represented right now. But anyhow, that was just some information to give you, and you do see there are some counties that have term limits, and there are some counties that do not. The one that was most interesting to me was Caswell County. Christopher spoke with the planning director there, and they told him that they were unsure if there was a term limit in Caswell County, and I believe he is a fairly new planning director there. So,
I understand they have a man that's been on there 25 years.
That sounds to me then they probably don't have a term limit.
Better than that.
And he is a realtor broker.
But what we have, as you recall, at the January 5th meeting, the commissioners, you all directed staff to prepare a proposed amended ordinance for your review. And at that meeting, there were a lot of things discussed. There was the option of an at-large position or at-large positions discussed. But at the core of this whole issue is the issue of term limits. And that is what everything boils down to. And so that is what, when I looked at the proposed amendment and asked Mr. Albright to review the proposed amendments, and he made some suggestions back to me, and this is what we've come up with. I've put my focus on that issue. Just to kind of summarize the amendments, and you should have a copy of the ordinance in your packet. The amendments are highlighted in yellow in the ordinance. In the second paragraph, just a bit of housekeeping there at the end of it, adding a statement that says a revision of which most recently occurred on August 6, 2007. That's to provide a nice flow of how the ordinance has changed. You can go back and look at what was previously adopted. The second change is the big one, and that's on the second page of the ordinance, and that deals with the term limit. And that's adding the language, retaining the two-term limit, 3-year term, 6 years total, retains that and adds language stating that in cases where a replacement for an outgoing member cannot be found, the Board of Commissioners may reappoint outgoing members for up to one additional term, or until a suitable replacement can be found, whichever comes first. And basically, that is exactly as it sounds. If there is a person that applies and can come back on the board, that reappointment is temporary. They would go off, the new person would come on. However, if there is not anybody within that term, that person could serve out an additional third term. And then also I took out the language here stating that and only one person from a particular township shall serve as a regular member of the board. And that was a point of one of the public comments earlier as to explain why we would do that. And as I said in my memo, that's to put the focus being on seniority on the board rather than your township. And the reason why is it is right now possible that somebody could be appointed to the board who represents a different township but now has voting power, but somebody that's been on the board for an entire term, but because they're behind somebody in terms of township, they still remain an alternate member with no voting power. The whole logic under when this ordinance was amended back in August of 2007, the logic that I had when I prepared that amendment was that this would be a position to where you never lose seniority, you never lose leadership on the board. Right now we have four members coming off, extraordinary amount of people coming off, the chair and the vice chair. This would allow people that are to become familiar with the procedures, with the rules of order of the board, and that you're not constantly training new people. There's people that have been on the board, they understand it, and they can move into the position to be on the voting, be a voting member. The point of being able to keep diversity on the board falls under not allowing more than two members from any township to serve on the board as a whole. But that is the, hopefully that I've explained that well, but that is why it was done that way. Also, the alternate is to be there in case somebody is sick. If somebody has to leave a meeting early, then your quorum does not suffer from it. Somebody can step in and be a regular member at that point and vote and still be able to get the county's business done at that meeting. And also, I did skip one piece of information that I added here, and that was, again, regarding the term limit. After six consecutive years, outgoing members shall be ineligible for reappointment for a period of 1 year unless reappointed by the Board of Commissioners as set forth above. And that's just a clarifying statement in the ordinance. That is all I have for you all at this time. I'll be glad to take any questions from the board.
Let me, in regards to the information that you've provided, and I called seven counties myself today, and the counties that you provided, did they tell you, all of them or any of them, that they require their planning members to be from a particular township?
Christopher, did any of them offer that? No. We did not ask that. But.
I just asked specifically what.
Yeah.
Right. Because, you know, you list Davidson and Randolph in here, and I talked to them as well, and they say they don't require theirs to be from a particular township.
Oh, okay.
But, okay, with that said, and then I'm sure we're going to come back for commissioner comments before we vote. Is that true? So we're not getting to that now. But I would like to ask a technical question about at what point would the commissioners vote on a member ourselves out here? In other words, if you had two people applying or three, I mean, at what point would it come here for us to look at?
For initial appointment to the board or reappointment?
In the process.
How we have done that is in the past, that has been done typically in December prior to the last meeting or of the year. That is when that has typically been done. Based on, I get information, I keep track of during the year who's coming up for reappointment. And then also I get a notice from the clerk to the board telling me that not just planning board, but the Historic Properties Commission as well. These members are set to come off, and if they're eligible to be reappointed, I'll contact them and ask, gauge their interest if they still would like to be reappointed and still are interested in serving on the board. And if they're not, then at that point, I typically start with the planning board as to who to, if they know anybody that's interested in coming on the board or announce it in a meeting. At that time, though, the quick answer to your question is in December is when this would actually come before the Board of Commissioners. And normally it's put in under the consent agenda.
There are circumstances where we would vote.
Oh, yeah.
As to who we, of the two or three.
Right.
Is it mandated in the ordinance that they have to come from a particular township?
No, it just states that it no more than two from any given township.
But it's not mandated that they come from a particular one, is that correct?
No.
Okay.
How do you advertise for this, Jason, or do you advertise?
Truthfully, I've never had to advertise for anything. I've been pretty well blessed. The folks have been able to be reappointed, with the exception of last year. David Holt was on the board, and he had reached his term limit. And we began with the request there with him. Did he know anybody? And he made a few recommendations, as well as, I would let the county manager know at that time too, and then applications would come in.
And have you filled that other position?
The current position that's open? Mm-hmm. No, but we have four applicants right now.
Okay.
I'm waiting until this is settled before
okay.
we look at that.
Okay.
Okay. Now, in that hypothetical situation,
mm-hmm.
those four people, one slot, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's got to come to us, right?
I think in that case, if there's, I have to look at what township they represent first, because that may rule them out right off the bat. For example, Newland Township is full, and I know I have one applicant from Newland Township, so they automatically can't be appointed right now, so they would be put on file. But if we have two from townships that do not have representation or are underrepresented, then we would bring that to the board.
Well, forgive me for beating this or belaboring
sure.
it, but I thought they didn't have to be from a particular township. So wouldn't that be on one end versus the other?
Well, no. I mean, if they can't have more than two from any given township, so that already establishes they got to be from an ordinance.
Right? Oh, yeah. Okay.
That's in here.
But theoretically, you can have two to three brought to us for that one spot. Right?
It could be possible. Yes.
And that would come up for a vote to the commission.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to get an answer to.
Yeah. Yeah. And if that, and basically, I would handle that however the board wants me to do that. If they want all three brought at one time, then that's how we would do it.
Jason,
I'm fine with that.
In studying these other counties, did any of them have like a nominating committee within the planning board?
Not to my knowledge, and I've not heard of that.
Okay.
But to be fair, I did not ask that question.
Okay.
May I ask a question? Can't you find two people out of this county that are qualified? these men have served two terms. In succession, don't you think you can find two competent people to serve that
well,
serve on this board?
We put three new ones on.
Four.
Three new ones on.
Yeah, we put three new ones on last time. Okay, and now we have one vacant spot, and we intend to fill that too. Okay, but yeah, we do have four applicants for that one spot right now.
Notify the public. Those positions are available.
Yeah, that's what I just asked.
Well, and that really needs to be a policy developed by the planning department. Truthfully,
I
need
like
to develop
to see a policy plan by the planning department.
I think we. That's the other thing that could
be in the
be
policy.
Established in the policy. Yeah.
There is no policy at the planning department.
Right.
I would like to have.
I do know that there are some counties and some cities that will advertise these in the newspaper. That's an option as well.
Okay.
And that's probably the easiest option, that and advertise it on the website so that the public knows.
Okay.
Jason.
Yes, ma'am.
It seems to me that I've seen on the website, you can go in and look for boards and check out the different boards that are there. And don't you have so many members will end that term December 31st of 08, and these people will end that term December of 2010 or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me if you're interested enough to be on one of these boards, you'd find a way to find out if there's a vacancy. I mean, if I'm interested in wanting to be on the planning board, I'm going to seek it out myself. I'm not going to look for something to come smack me in the face and say, oh, well, there it is.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's me.
Well, everybody doesn't have a computer.
Right.
Well, no, but you can call down here, and that's going to shoot me, and find out when there's some expired terms on whatever board that you want, and she can give you that information.
And I think what Jason is saying, we need to develop that policy as to how we need to do that as far as advertising and moving forward with getting it out so the public does know the
If I may, the other thing I can say is that I'm also looking at currently training for the planning board right now on, you know, meeting procedures and things like that. Okay. And that also, and I want the planning board to develop their own set of bylaws for the planning board. And of course, I will help them do that, but I think they need to do that. And at the same time, this could be part of their bylaws.
Right.
I think that's something that...
Jason and I had talked about this. And,
sure.
And I did ask him if he would check into that about the bylaws.
Yeah. I think it's something that is absolutely necessary with that board. Okay. And I think even the members on the board would have been there.
Okay. Do we have any other comments from the public on that? Yes, sir. You can come back here. Jason will move right over for you.
Sorry.
And you can directly ask Jason, too, if you
if
you have any questions on
it. Well, Jason may be able to answer some of those, I guess. I was waiting for the formal announcement for public comments. I'm afraid it'd be lost in the other room. So, anyway, thanks again. Anyway, welcome this opportunity to discuss how we might consider improving the planning board so they can be structured to fairly represent all county residents. First, let me say that I'm at a loss to understand the statement by Commissioner Sutton, as quoted in the Alamance News, saying, "I have a problem with trying to orchestrate a different view on this board." My interpretation of that statement is that it is not supportive of a policy which would allow fair representation of a wide variety of viewpoints on the planning board, and I hope I'm wrong.
What was the statement again?
Well, it was, I've had the Alamance News misquote me or loosely quote me. So
are you paraphrasing me or is it
no,
a great quote?
No, actually, I copied it right out of the paper, and I've got it in quotation marks here. It says, "I have a problem with trying to orchestrate a different view on this board."
Okay.
So, and that's why I say I hope I'm wrong on that.
I do.
So, okay.
And we'll
talk
about
that's
that.
That's fine. Fair enough. Yeah. Fair enough. Anyway, in 2006, the county conducted successful and very well attended community outreach meetings in an attempt to involve citizens on how Alamance County should develop its land use plan. The results of those meetings clearly show residents wanted more participation and county control over growth and decisions on land use. In that spirit, I think the county should continue to encourage different views be represented on the planning board. Term limits is one method that helps the planning board be more responsive by allowing a cross-section of residents to exchange ideas of how to coexist while accommodating different citizen priorities. Now, I know that democracy requires the willingness of citizens to participate to ensure widespread representation. And if citizens don't actually step forward, then the community can only hold itself to blame when they find their views not fairly represented in the selection of planning board members. But the selection process must also be welcoming, open, and accessible to the wider public to allow for differing views. This is the problem with appointed boards. Voters don't get a chance to judge applicants. Therefore, all board members must realize that their somewhat protected position does not give them carte blanche to ignore the wider community. In view of this opportunity presented to amend the planning board ordinance, I would like to see the following changes. The proposed clause that will allow existing members whose term is about to expire be reappointed for another term if no replacement comes forward should only be for a one-year term, not the proposed three-year term. Right now, the planning board can be at full membership with not all townships represented. We need to make sure full county representation is possible, so I would like this addressed with a change to the ordinance. There should be a public understanding of how commissioners select board members. I would like to know what criteria commissioners use at present, and if none exists, then maybe there needs to be some written guidelines. If the proposed term, suitable replacement, is used in the ordinance, then suitable needs to be clearly defined. All information currently on the planning board members list should be posted on the planning board website and not just available from the county manager's office, as well leaving the workspace blank on the roster should not be an option, and use of the term retired should also show what that member did when employed and if also now working show present occupation. Right now, the planning board ordinance is not posted on the county website, so I think that needs to be updated. Jason has addressed that. The planning board application form should also be available on the planning board webpage with instructions and time when board positions are open to applicants. When board member positions are coming due for change, I would like to see reasonable public notice given in local newspapers and on the planning board website. And this is a small thing, but to the planning board. Please provide name cards at planning board meetings so the public can better reference each member. I would like to see the board conduct more informal public meetings in the community on specific planning issues to elicit guidance and opinions from citizens, as is part of their duties outlined in the planning board ordinance. And I think there needs to be a general mission statement as part of the planning board ordinance, and I submit the following as a proposal to be the starting point for discussion, which I hope will not only guide board members in their decisions, but also commissioners in choosing members and approving policy. I'm not going to read it, but if I could hand one to each of the commissioners, is that possible? That would save some time. And I'll give one to Jason as well. Appreciate this.
Thanks, sir.
And that's it. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Okay.
May I address the comment directly?
Sure, yeah, please do. Yeah, I think it needs to be clear.
Because I have a lot that I'm going to be talking about at the end before we vote. But okay. No, that was not taken out of context at all.
Okay.
Because, and this is a matter of opinion.
I knew you said you had a right to assume. I remember you saying that.
Again, you know, we live in a society where hopefully we'll never be held back from what we believe.
Okay.
It's when it goes below the belt that we're going against what our founding fathers, I think, intended for. What I meant by that was, to me, there's a difference between wanting to serve versus pushing an agenda. And I believe with all my heart, I could be wrong, that the protests that we have had about the planning committee, its structure, some of the people that I would like to see stay on there versus what we're hearing from the podium here, I believe it's an organized effort to push an agenda. To me, that's a big, and I can't prove that. I have a right to believe that. And that's what I was talking about. I see a concerted effort here, clearly, in my opinion, to change the philosophy of our board toward a more liberal zoning, pro-environmental. Not that I'm against any of that, but I would like to see a more honest desire to be involved versus have a concerted effort to infiltrate versus the willingness to just serve. To me, there's a big difference.
Is it possible that existing members also have their own agendas?
Sure.
And so are we to assume then that the so-called liberal agenda is not the correct agenda, but only the members that serve on the board, their agenda is correct?
After the election, all this is obviously changed. But
we all have agendas, Commissioner Sutton. You know that.
Well, the truth is, the truth should be the agenda that we're all after. I trust the desires that I've seen on the board by some of the people that are on there more than others as far as their interest in the common person of Alamance County, the common property owner of Alamance County.
Yeah, am I not a common property owner?
I have made my point as clear as I know how to make it.
Well, I'm not sure.
I don't see as much as an agenda.
You define common.
I don't see as much as an agenda from their position as I do the people that are coming here. Yes, it is liberal versus conservative. I'll admit that.
Well, maybe that's why you should look at the mission statement and maybe try to.
Yeah.
Maybe the board needs more guidance, because I was very careful in this to make sure that. That builders have a say, okay. Real estate agents have a say, okay. Their side of the story is as important as anyone's side of the story. So, but we just need to make sure that we try to get a mix of
sure.
community opinions,
no problem.
And that's what impressed me about those outreach community meetings. I think the community went to those with the fair assumption that their views would be considered. If I have a right to assume something, I haven't seen where those general views from those public hearings have been incorporated in the decisions of the planning board. So I guess we can argue back and forth about agendas all night, but I think what we need is a fair representation of everyone's agenda.
Uh-huh.
And maybe in that, try to get to some kind of common goal for everybody in the county. So, as I said, maybe a mission statement is the way to do it for both sides. Okay?
Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Any other comments? Yes, sir.
Uh,
It's on planning board then?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Commissioners, I'd just like to speak on this planning board issue. I think that we need to leave the ordinance that's in place. I am in favor of the term limits. I have served on appointed boards by you through the Volunteer Ag District. Our district, you know, our board is a three-year, two-year term as well. I would make a suggestion that, as on our board, is when we got outgoing members, we asked each of the nine members that are there, you know, to nominate someone that they feel like would be a good representation to serve on that board. And we get a large list of people, and we call those people and ask them would they be willing to serve. And then we present these list of people to y'all to let y'all determine which one you'd like to serve. I think this is a fair and equitable way of doing this, and I think we need to continue doing this. I also think that we need some, you know, maybe new changes or whatever. And each and every one of you know how I feel on this land use plan study that we done. We spent good tax dollars on it. It's sitting on the shelf collecting dust. And I think this planning board needs to get it out and get a plan in place. Now's the time to do it. Our development is down. We're slowed down. Now's the time to get it in place so that our county can move forward and keep growing, and keep growing in a way that will be suitable for everybody. We don't want to cut the builder out. We don't want to cut the farmer out. We don't want to cut the industry out. And I think that's where we need this diversity on the board, different people. And I honestly cannot believe that if people across this county know that these positions were there, that there wouldn't be somebody to step forward. I know that you can contact the Farm Bureau. I know that you can contact the Chamber of Commerce, the Building Home Builders Association, and I'm sure that out of that group of organizations, along with other organizations, that they will come up with some names to fill these positions, and you won't have a problem getting these places. So I urge you and encourage you to leave this ordinance alone. I think it's worked. It's clearly not been followed in some cases with people serving on the board for 9 to 12 years that should not have been. And I thank you for your time, and let me speak.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else? Anybody else? Okay, Jay. Mr. Burke, I'm sorry. Called you by your first name.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name's Jay Burke. I'm the outgoing Vice Chairman of the Planning Board. I just want to tell you it's been an honor and a privilege and a pleasure to serve for the last 9 years on the board. I really enjoyed it. I've enjoyed working with Clyde and Chris and Jason, and you have three people there who are genuinely interested in Alamance County's best interest. I have full confidence in those people. I appreciate you allowing me to serve on the board. I do believe that it is a good idea to have a term limit on the board. I do want to make something clear. There seems to be a little bit of confusion tonight because I get the impression from some of the people who've come up here and spoken that there's some clandestine way that you get on the planning board or you stay on the planning board, and that the deck is stacked. The plain simple truth is there is an extremely difficult, we have an extremely difficult time in getting people on the board and getting them to attend the meetings. In 9 years, I've missed two meetings. I feel like if you're going to be on a board, you need to be there. But I want to clear the air and make sure that everybody's aware that there's not some secret way you get on or you stay on. In the past, the planner had typically not checked the roster to see how long people had been on or had not cared to enforce it. You have a very objective planner now in Jason Martin, and he calls things just like he sees it. And he brought it to our attention, and we said, well, if we need to go off the board, we will. And Basically, if there was nobody to take our place, then we would stay as long as we needed to.
Okay.
But it's been a pleasure to serve, and I appreciate it, and I'd be happy to serve on any other boards that you might allow me to serve on.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you,
Jay, for serving.
Anybody else? Any commissioners have any?
Yeah, you want to see.
I'm sorry. Hold on.
Somebody get old.
Better than that alternative, then.
My name's A.J. Holt. I've lived in this county all my life. I'm probably the oldest citizen is in this room today. Passed 85 some time ago, and I've seen a lot of things happen. This has been a great county, and I've been proud of it. But let me tell you something. We're in the most desperate situation right now that has ever been in my lifetime. The economy is not going to get any better soon. But you people are going to be faced with some problems that I don't know how you're going to solve them. I listened to the television, watched it today, where we've got about four schools, high schools, that are overcrowded right now, way overcrowded. But you can't bleed the turnip just so far. And you're going to have a situation that I don't know how you're going to, we can't so much tax. I've always made my tax. But now we've come to a time when the young people who are getting married and trying to raise a family and don't have a job, they're going to resort to violence. You look in the paper, in the Greensboro News today, see how many murders there were over there yesterday. You need to pray about this thing because you're going to need some help. I'm willing to do everything I possibly can to help. But it's going to take some concentrated thinking. And these people who are county employees that have high salaried positions, I know they're very valuable. But we just can't keep putting more and more into their pockets. And these young people, their kids are going hungry. They're losing their homes. They're losing everything they've got. Y'all didn't see what I saw in the 30s when I was a boy growing up. We're in that situation today. I didn't mean to say anything, but I just couldn't help myself.
I appreciate
thank
that.
You,
and I thank you for letting me say that.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Anybody here have any comments on the...
Who wants to start?
Anybody else over at the next round? Oh,
you know, on these ordinances, y'all are pulling these ordinances up. Like you was talking about, Ms. Vaughn, that you looked at an ordinance on the internet, I think you said earlier. And you talking about what you have seen on the internet, we're looking at the internet too much. Whatever happened to common sense thinking? We don't think with common sense no more. Does a computer rule it all?
Well, Mr. Cox, what I was trying to say is if you're interested in a particular area, like a board, you can go on the internet, on that website, and locate that board and see where that possibly would be a vacancy coming up. No, true, I can pick up the phone and she can do it. But why can't I do it if I have access to a computer?
But it's like...
And I know everybody doesn't, but...
But it's like there's no common sense thinking anymore. Just like the high-impact land use ordinance. The county out there, you got all these people coming into the county, building these big homes, trying to change the county, they're ripping the trees from the land out there and everything. But you want the people that are from the county that don't want all this stuff out there. That's why we live in the county. Because we don't want to live right up next to somebody else. We don't want somebody looking over our fence and then telling us that we can't look over theirs. Or what's pretty to them ain't pretty to us. Or what's pretty to us ain't pretty to them. It's just a never-ending struggle.
Have you got any comments on the public hearing for the planning ordinance, okay?
Well, I thought we was talking about ordinances altogether.
No, basically, this is a public hearing for the planning ordinance, okay? the public comments while I gave, but this is the public hearing.
Well, it kind of threw me off whenever, okay, whenever you threw me under the rug while ago.
I didn't throw you under the rug.
Well, you know, I was drugged through the mud in the public. Let's drag me out of the mud in the public.
Well, you know, we are in a public hearing. Thank you. Any comments from the commissioners on the public hearing for the planning ordinance?
Yeah, I'll go ahead and start. The information that was provided by Jason from the counties that they contacted, I have to ask you to take a look at the ones that claim no limits versus the ones that claim term limits. The surprise really was Rockingham County. Rockingham was on my list. I'd called them today and mentioned the internet. I don't believe I mentioned internet tonight.
Well, I wasn't sure. But
yeah, I mean, I made cell phone calls. My cell phone ran out on the back of an envelope. That's hardly the internet. It's my opinion that if you look at the list of the ones with no limits versus the ones that have limits, are clearly county comparisons that, in my opinion, the counties have more respect for the property owner who have no limits, in my opinion. The ones that have no limits, I think, are more concerned about reasonable rules as to how you are to deal with your own property, but not overbearing rules. The ones that have, well, those counties were Davidson and Randolph and Rockingham, and then the three counties that had term limits were Guilford, Orange, and Forsyth. Hardly conservative property rights counties, if that's the right language, in my opinion. You know, the contrast is obvious to me. I may be incorrect. But here's what I did today. I, at random, called what I thought were counties that were mirrors of our county, socioeconomically, which includes median income, population, so forth and so on. No, I didn't call Guilford, because I don't think they're a comparison. I didn't call Mecklenburg, so forth. But the first one I called was Randolph County. Randolph County says they have no limits, which his report agrees with. They have people on their board that's been on their board as many as 20 years. 20 years. Now, all these counties are counties that have countywide zoning. And in my opinion, a county that probably has no countywide zoning should probably be even more compatible with the property owner in general, the common person, and we can debate what's common, but Randolph says that they leave it up to their county commissioners to appoint people on the planning committee. There is no locked-in ordinance that says that the county commissioners can't put somebody on that board or take them off. Davidson County, they have no limits. They have a person on their board that's been on their board as many as 12 years. Talked to their planning director. He's been there since 1986, and he told me what he felt was that you needed a planning committee that was compatible with the current board of commissioners rather than have a planning committee who was going to be contentious with and have a debate going all the time, or even though we do have the final say as to what is approved or disapproved, that he would rather see a compatible situation rather than one where there's differences all the time. Cabarrus County, they have no limits that I was told, that special waivers were available through the county commissioners. Iredell County has 4-year terms. No limit. County commissioners are in full control of it. They have a person on their board that's been on their board 20 years. Johnson County, and I was surprised at some of these. Johnson County has you serve for 10 years, 2-year terms. At the end of 10 years, you can get a waiver from the commissioners to go another 2 years, and for 12, and then you can get another waiver if there are no, if there's nobody applying for that position for a total of 14 years. Catawba, no limits. They have a person on their board, and all of these boards are extremely, and I don't mean to be, I know this is going to be contentious here, but I'm impressed by their planning boards. I'm impressed by their planning departments. I mean, we've even had Catawba come up here, if I'm not, or Cabarrus, come up here and discuss planning with us. Catawba has a man on their board that's been on their board for 35 years. In Rockingham County. But I called seven counties in a row, and none of them had a situation to where the commissioners could not get involved immediately. So, you know, I've been under the impression that what we had here was the norm. In other words, what you were presenting here and the plant was the norm. It's not the norm with our peers as far as socioeconomic counties, in my opinion. And that's been, you know, my complaint all along. I don't think we've researched it enough. It's sad that I had to dig this out. You finally brought this to us, but you know, my cell phone ran out today on me while I had to make all these phone calls. But I see a trend here clearly in these seven counties that I called in. I didn't cherry pick. I don't think anybody can claim that the counties I just mentioned—Rockingham, Catawba, Johnson, Iredell, Cabarrus, Davidson, Randolph. That there's any cherry picking involved. But the pattern is there that the commissioners are in full control and they're not locked in by a particular ordinance that says they can't put somebody on or take somebody off. Matter of fact, one of the counties said they fired their whole planning committee, started with a new one. But with all that said, I'll be quiet, but. I think I've made my point.
Tim, out of those, how many were already under zoning
orders? They're all countywide zoning.
So all of them did already have zoning in place.
Right. All of them have countywide zoning, and but they have a very reasonable appointment process as far as the commissioners. You know, I would think it would be if you didn't have countywide zoning that you might be more strict, but.
If I may.
Sure.
My name is Lynn Horn, and I just want to find out what is the relevance of finding out what other counties are doing with their governments. Alamance County is Alamance County. Why are we looking to Orange County, Catawba, and Iredell? I mean, I hate to use the cliche comparing apples to oranges, but we're comparing Alamance to Orange County, are we not? And
well, if I can,
looks like some of us are.
You actually didn't like my report, but you know, we don't live in a vacuum in America.
Right.
We don't live in a vacuum when it comes to government. We don't live in a vacuum when it comes to business. I mean, Goodyear tires, they go buy a Michelin tire, cut it apart, and see what they're doing that they're not doing. If you don't think you can get good ideas from another place, you're not doing enough research.
Well, now I understand that. But as far as keeping the same people on the board for 20-some years, you keep a bucket of water with the same water in it for a while, for a long time, that water's going to get stagnant. And that's what's going to happen with the board. It's going to get stagnant. We need new blood in it.
We got new blood.
Yeah. Well, good. Well, we need some more of it. Our government is getting stale. We need new blood, new ideas. Thank you.
Thank you.
We've had a significant change in the planning board just here recently. I mean, we've got a lot of new faces there. And we've got, as Jason talked about, we've got several people that have applied. There's a waiting list right now. So there's folks, new folks wanting to come on. And before the first person got up at the last meeting to speak on this, I'd already pretty much made up my mind. You know, Mother told me years ago, said, look, if it's not broke, you know, don't fix it. And I cleaned that up a little bit, Bob. but as the policy's written, I think we've got a good policy. I really do. And I don't know how many years it's been in effect. Probably 20 years or more, as far as the term limits. I think we're in good shape, and I don't see any need in changing it. Certainly, when you look at Mr. Burke and Mr. Cobb, very loyal. And it is a thankless job, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to tell you that right now. When you serve on these committees, and they both were very loyal. They were there. If there was an open meeting, they were there. I know, because I served on the planning board for a good while as a commissioner. And it's not like we're throwing folks under the bus. We're saying, look, your terms have expired. You're going off for a year. And after that year, if you would like to serve again, you may reapply. And you will be considered. So in respect to that, I don't have any problems with the ordinance as it is written.
Eddie? I tend to agree with you, Dan, on that, because I think probably part of the problem in the past has been the fact that we've really not advertised that these positions were coming open and coming on as a new chairman of the planning board or county commissioner liaison. I want us to be sure to work through that policy on this board and get it out so the public knows when these positions are going to come open. And like Dan said, I think it has been working, but I think maybe there's been a lapse in the direction of how it's worked. And I think that's probably what we need to look at more, is the policy of how to get this advertisement out so people know that these positions are available. And as far as Jay and Ray, I know they've done a good job, but also, just in saying this, I want to make a note that, you know, you got to be at the meetings. Just put your name down and say, I want to be a member, is not just going to help out. So,
okay. Ann, any comment?
Yeah, I wanted to ask a question of Jason. Did it come up in a planning board meeting that there could possibly be any changes, and didn't the board decide to leave things as they were? In other words, to have the limits and have the...
When the ordinance was amended in 2007, there existed a term limit already. It was the exact same thing, 2 terms, 3-year terms, 6 years, came off for 1 year to be reappointed. That ordinance amendment was taken to the planning board. The planning board voted unanimously to approve it. It was brought to the commissioners. It was voted unanimously by the commissioners. And then the second reading, it was voted unanimously. So, I mean, there was a public hearing held on it, and I believe even the minutes of the meeting from both. I know I went back and listened to the audio of the planning board meeting. I stated that we would retain that term limit. And then at the commissioners meeting, I believe the July 2nd meeting, the minutes reflected I said that then.
And that was done
then? Yeah, July 2nd, 2007, and then August of 2007 was the second reading.
Uh-huh. Well, I know I've spoken before about Jay and Ray, and I also have served on the planning board as a commissioner, and I can tell you, saw it with my own eyes, Ray was there when he should have stayed at home and been in the bed and dragged himself there anyway. These people are dedicated people, and this is what these boards need. If you can be dedicated and attend these meetings and be part of these meetings, take the initiative or call Pat Jones and find out what boards are open and what you can do to, you can download those applications off the internet. You can come by here and pick up one. Mm-hmm. So they are available. You just take the initiative. If you take the initiative, I know then you will probably be a good board member.
And I think, and without a doubt, Jay and Ray both have been very dedicated planning board members. I think Jay, in the 6 years that I've been here, or going on 6 years that I've been here, I don't recall Jay ever missing a meeting, you know, back when I would work on the minutes and stuff for the planning director at the time. And since I've been the director for almost 3 years now, I don't recall, other than maybe one time, Jay missed a meeting. And I don't ever remember, take that back, Ray took a vacation one time and missed a meeting.
And that's not the issue, as whether they were good or bad. The issue is we have an ordinance, and that ordinance should be followed, because we make other people follow our ordinances. So I think we need to do the same thing as county commissioners and follow what the ordinance says. And this is exactly what we did, is follow the ordinance. So, but that's what this was about, because we had somebody ask for changes, and thank you for that. When do you possibly think we might have something in writing about a policy for the planning?
I will make that starting in the next meeting. That'll be an agenda item, and until we get it done.
Okay.
And I'll bring that back to the Board of Commissioners as a report.
Yeah, because I know they do not have any bylaws or anything whatsoever. So I appreciate your help on that.
That's not a problem. We will make that an agenda item.
Okay.
Thank you.
Jason.
Good job. What about whenever planning board members they know a material fact in a controversial ordinance? Shouldn't they have to speak to the truth of that ordinance?
Well, everybody should speak to the truth, but everybody doesn't do that, and
exactly.
There's the problem. But, you know, I can't make you tell the truth just like you can't make me tell the truth.
But
I don't want to tell the truth, and you know, I can't make anybody do that, and neither can anybody else in here make anybody tell the truth if they're not going to tell it.
But under these ordinances, if you're going to give people death sentences under these ordinances, then shouldn't the truth be told?
Well, it should be, yes, at all times, but it's not always told.
But
I mean,
people come in here and tell lies.
Sure.
Shouldn't they be held to a standard?
Well, you have to prove that there's a lie there.
Well, you're
and
doing,
there's the 9 yards.
Well, that's easily proved.
Well, not necessarily.
Yes, ma'am, necessarily. Believe me, in this one it
well,
is.
Well, believe me. Well, that's something you and I will talk about to Clyde, okay?
Well,
Mr. Albright, okay?
My time's running short on it.
Well,
so.
I'll get you. I have my schedule out for the rest of January, so we'll see what we can come up with, okay? Before we leave. How's that?
Before we leave
tonight. Are you going to stay for the whole meeting? We may be here till midnight.
That's fine.
I promise I'm going to do my best to not allow that to happen.
Okay.
Thank you.
Nothing else? At this time, I will open...
What are you going to?
I was going to open the floor for...
Motions.
Oh,
okay.
At this time, I will open the floor for a motion.
Is it a need for a motion since we're not changing anything?
Well, we don't know that we're not changing.
Okay, is there...
Because this is what's proposed, so I think we do have to have a motion to either accept the current ordinance or to vote...
Well, I want to see where everybody stands, and, you know, this, in my opinion, what Clyde is offering is better than what we had. It's still not as good as it ought to be. And I can't be more determined to tell you that.
So are you putting...
I'm making a motion that we accept the amended ordinance as has been described.
The one on the second page.
The one that we had...
The first page. Well, it's all the whole thing.
Yeah.
I do not have a second.
I'm not surprised.
Okay. So I guess that's... You're dead in the water.
For now.
Okay.
I'll be back another day.
Okay. At this point, that motion does not have a second, so we don't vote on that one. So I will entertain another motion.
I would make a motion that we leave the ordinance as written.
I'll second that.
Okay. A motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
And I'm aye. One no. Okay, we're going to leave the ordinance as it stands. Okay. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. The next is the planning matter, so don't leave. The mobile home appeal. And if we would get, is it Ms. Cox on here is what it says, yeah. But I believe she signed her name there.
Penny Gross, I believe.
Gross, Penny Gross. Ms. Gross, please come in.
I think her brothers might be with her.
Whoever is with her.
I think she said that.
Grosses. Said they're coming.
Commissioners, I have it's a very brief presentation for you. What you have before you tonight is an appeal of the dead storage manufactured home ordinance. Ms. Cox has been specifically cited as having one mobile home that is considered a class 3 mobile home or a significant public nuisance. And just kind of going through my memo here, in October 17th of 2008, planning staff performed a visual inspection of the mobile home on 5075 Snow Camp Road. At that time, staff observed several conditions that existed that clearly constituted a violation of the ordinance, and a notice of violation was affixed to the mobile home as required by the ordinance. At that time, contact was made with the planning department advising us that the property had been foreclosed upon by the lending institution, that they were no longer the owners. After extensive research regarding the ownership and the status of the foreclosure, staff found that the property had not been foreclosed upon. So on December 12th of 2008, we started the procedure again and sent out another notice of violation. And this time it was sent to all three property owners. Under the ordinance, it specifies that if there's more than one property owner or one owner of the mobile home, then all three of them are liable. So all three of them have been cited. Ms. Pennycox exercised her appeal right and appealed tonight. So just we'll jump right into the photographs here. It's just a handful of them. This was taken in October of 2008. Mm-hmm. And as you see, most of the siding's been pulled off of it. Several open doors and windows broken in it.
That's a double wide, isn't it?
I believe it is one, but it's a half of one right now.
That's what I meant.
Yeah. Insulation exposed there. There's a good close view of the broken glass there. I do recall that particular day, it was a very muddy day on the property. There's the actual notice of violation that we sent, that we post on these. It's a extraordinarily bright orange. The debris and whatnot laying around there as well. This is a picture from January 9th, 2009. If anything, the condition of the mobile home has deteriorated more. These were taken by Christopher Ong, the planner. There's some more closer photos of the mobile home. It looks like he made a friend out there that day on the left. And just to kind of summarize, Class 3 mobile homes, Article 1, Section 2D of the Alamance County Ordinance regulating the storage of manufactured homes states, Class 3 mobile home, a mobile home or manufactured home which rises to the level of significant public nuisance, such a home may display one or more of the following characteristics: so situated that it is in danger of it falling or turning over, has utilities that are being run by electric cords that extend from another structure, is unstructurally sound, is a point of concentrated quantities of gasoline, oil, or other flammable and explosive materials as evidenced by odor, is a point of collection of garbage, food waste, animal waste, or any other rotten or putrescent matter of any kind, has points of access which are not secured or is missing doors and windows, has parts thereof which are jagged or contain sharp edges of metal or glass. And then Article 1, Section 3F states regarding nonconformance, after the 30-day period for compliance has expired, the administrator shall assess the nonconformance fees if the violation has not been remedied. Beginning on the first day after the expiration of the period for compliance, the owner of the manufactured home and owner of the property upon which the manufactured home is placed shall incur nonconformance fees. After this first citation, the owner has 7 days to correct the violation or make satisfactory progress to correct the violation before additional nonconformance fees are assessed. If the violation is not remedied by the eighth day, a second citation and fine will be issued, after which the owner has 3 days to correct the violation. Any violation beyond this time period will result in each day's violation being considered a separate and distinct offense that is subject to a fine. And here is the schedule of nonconformance fees. The notice of violation is a warning. At that time, they're given their appeal rights, which if they appeal, we stay any enforcement until the appeal is settled. After that, the first citation for a Class 3 mobile home in this case is $250. The second citation is a $500 citation, and then after that, every day is a $500 a day citation nonconformance fee. Staff's recommendation: staff believes that this mobile home constitutes a Class 3 mobile home as defined by the ordinance based on the following facts. It is structurally unsound, has sharp points or metal or glass, broken windows. Point of collection of garbage, unsecured access, missing doors and windows. Therefore, staff recommends denial of this appeal and requested a separate motion authorizing the planning and legal department to proceed with enforcement as prescribed by the ordinance. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions at this time.
Whose name is the land in?
It is in all three property owners as well.
How about the home?
The home is as well, and I actually went back to the tax records back to the early 90s, and it matched up even then. I do want to just state one thing, because I know this is of Ms. Cox's, it's of most importance to her, is that all three owners have been cited, and we will continue enforcement on all three. It's not for one person to bear, at least not in the eyes of the county. So.
I'd like to, Ms. Cox, do you want to say anything?
Yeah.
Come up here, please.
Jason said that, you know, I mean, as far as those fines, no, I didn't know they were that much. I had no idea. And as far as, and my mom and my brother's back in the next room. I mean, you know, so as far as them not, you know, calling him, that's not my fault. You know, I tried to get her to call and talk to him, and she told me that she did. I can't make her pick up the telephone. So I didn't know that this was going to fall back to me, and I'm sure my brother didn't know it was going to fall back to him either until I got a letter in the mail. So I called Jason and I talked to him, and he was honest about it, and he told me that, you know, he would deny. And the one question he told me, he said, I'll tell you, I'm going to deny it. He said, because I don't feel that one person should be held responsible for it, which is true. But because my name is on the deed. He said, so we'll try to make sure that, you know, you're held a third responsible. Okay, but if you're not going to send anybody out there to clean this up, if I have to do it, then how can y'all guarantee me that I'm only going to have to pay one third? If I have to sit down with them and say, okay, look, this is what we have. We're in a dumpster, or we can get someone to come in and clean it up. If y'all leave that responsible to all of us, I can't make them pay that. And I'll be quite honest, I don't have the money to pay that, and I don't. I mean, yeah, I have a full-time job, but it's very slow. You know, I mean, this may not have been what they wanted, and they may not like what I say, but that's too bad, because I'm tired of all this crap coming back to me. Like when they forgot to pay their taxes 1 year. I got a letter at work. They were going to garnish my wages. Now, I didn't live there in 11 years. I had moved out, and they were still living in that house. I didn't tell them to put it back there. You know, they should have let the mobile home people take it when they came to get it.
Of course, the other part of it.
I have no idea.
What would it cost to remove that, Jason? Do you know what?
Haven't you done that in the past?
Yeah.
With a company?
We don't pay for it, though. Right. I do have to tell
yeah.
you. That we don't pay for it, but
right. The price of scrap metal's down right now.
Madam Chair, I can tell you that from our recycling program, we had a mover that would move them, excuse me, for $800 a mobile home. Mm-hmm.
But
then there's a $250 tipping fee at the landfill.
Yeah.
But at that time, the price of scrap metal was $192 a ton. Yeah. I checked with them last week. I think it's down below $30 a ton.
Which means?
Our recycling program's on hold until it goes back up. But as far as she's talking about, if the other two property owners don't want to take care of the property, they should deed it to you and you should sell it.
But see, here's the thing, though. I can't. Because, I said, they borrowed, my name's on the deed, okay?
Well, if this follows the natural course, you may be able to buy it at the courthouse steps.
Okay.
Right.
But
what we'll do is we'll clean it up. We get a court order ordering us to clean it up. We'll clean it up. We'll sell it in the nature of a tax foreclosure sale.
Right.
On the
courthouse steps, you can come by.
This is the thing that gets me. They don't need my signature to go into a bank and borrow money. But yet, I'm left out of that part. But, you know, when it comes time that it's we got to get this cleaned up, I somehow all come into play. I mean, if I have to clean it up, I have to clean it up. I understand that.
That's unfortunate.
Because I really didn't even know it was that bad. I mean, like I said, if I have to do it, I have to do it. My biggest thing is, just say, for example, if I call a guy and I say, can you come clean this up? He says, yeah. He says, I'm going to charge you $4,500 to clean it up, okay? Now, you see, y'all are not sending these people out because you're going to leave it up to us to take care of that, right? But
is that right, Clyde?
Well, unless they choose not to clean it up, basically.
Yeah. But yeah. Jason's telling me, though, that I won't be held responsible by myself. But this is what I want to know. How can y'all tell me that I won't be responsible by myself, but we have to get all this by ourselves? So if I go to them and say, okay, where's your third and your third? Well, they can look at me and say, well, I don't have it. And to be honest, I would rather clean it up than get fined $500 a day because I don't have that either.
Do you live on this property where this is located?
No, I live in Ramsor, and they don't live on it either.
Okay, so basically then, as Clyde said, it would be so at the courthouse steps if we were forced to have to do the cleanup. And couldn't collect. So.
Who was the last to live in the house?
My mom and brother. They're back there.
So they deserted it.
Well, what happened was it was my mom, my brother, and my stepdad. My real dad bought that trailer and put it there. He's been dead for well over 20 years. And the trailer was very old, and it has started, you know, the shingles had started, you know, leaking on it and everything like that. So they went and got a new single wide. When the trailer place came out to move the double wide, they said it was so old that they were afraid to pull it down the highway. You know, but, I mean, they could have come up with some other arrangements. And like I said, you know, then they had issues. He went his way, she went her way. So, I mean, you know, it's not just her, you know. I mean, I blame him too.
Okay. It's really unfortunate your name is on that deed when they should be responsible for what you're saying.
That's how I feel about it, but I'm sure they don't back there.
And we can't take yours off either.
Right.
Okay.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I think I heard something about repossession on that. Wouldn't that be the bank's property that they've just not put into their name until they auction it or whatever?
I have no idea.
You know what I'm talking about? So it could actually be the banks.
It could. That may be a remedy she could get.
Exactly.
No, because they won't do it. My mom's done called. See, they won't tell me anything because I didn't sign the loan. She called. Even though she's not made payments in 5 months, they're not going to repo it. Basically, really, I mean, what it comes down to,
is anybody
they're not
going
to repo the land because they don't want to clean that crap up. Now, I guarantee you, once it's cleaned up, they'll come repo it. Yeah, I mean, basically, I just want to know if I have to do half of it, I do. But, you know, I mean, I don't feel that I should have to do it by myself.
Jason. Yeah.
Madam Chair, if I may, and I have Christopher here who's done a lot of the research and the investigation on this, but I believe that we have been contacted by the mother on this. Mm-hmm. And was told that the bank would not foreclose on it until it was cleaned up, and they had asked for additional time to get it done, and there was going to be efforts made to have it moved by the 23rd of January. And I think Christopher, you went out this morning, didn't you?
We were told that they hope to have it done by January 23rd. They couldn't do it the week before because of the conditions. It was too wet. I was at this morning, and it was about the same as you saw it in the last slide.
So
do we not think they should tell us too as well when they plan to have this done rather than just Ms. Cox?
Well, it still remains staff's, you know, priority to try to work with people, even if we deny the appeal here. They have to get rid of it, and I would be, you know, open to still working with them on a time frame. But there has been measurable milestones.
Okay.
I have to see progress. And
so are they in the planning stage at this time?
We are not. We have not issued a citation yet that actually puts in the nonconformance fees. Mm-hmm. They have to. They during the time of a notice of violation, they can appeal.
Okay.
But we are, after this meeting, we would, once that initial time frame is up, we would allow the remainder of the clock per se to keep ticking, and then we would issue out a citation to them.
Okay. Any comments? Any more questions?
I have a question, and maybe as to what a reasonable time frame would be to expect this to get moved or work out something.
Can I say something before
sure.
you do that?
Sure.
You know, if I am half responsible,
a third.
There is one thing that I do ask if it's possible, because I didn't know about this as soon as they did. You know, because I've called you and worked with you, you know, as much as I had. If you would do the same in return with me, if you would at least give me a little bit more time, that way I can, you know, get some stuff together, maybe get some people down there so I can go ahead and get it done. Because if I have, my husband knows how to use the equipment, so if we have to rent it, then I'd like to get it all done in one day. Because, you know, that's money out of my pocket.
Okay. Would 60 days be a time that you might could live with?
Well, Could I possibly ask for 90? I mean, and one thing too is I will say, if it rains a lot down there, see, there's no topsoil on that land at all. It's all been took off. And if it rains, you know, for 2 or 3 days, it gets almost impossible to get back there to the bank. I mean, you know, Jason even knows it gets very, very muddy. And to get a piece of equipment out there, I would be, you know, afraid that I don't want to mess up something that I'm trying to rent.
That is true. The mud is extremely thick on that property. I have a pair of ruined shoes to prove it. Of course.
I think you should take action on the appeal first. And then you can instruct Jason on how you want to handle it first.
Okay.
A separate motion.
All right. At this time, I will do a motion.
I'll move that we deny the appeal.
Second.
And second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, now we will ask that you work with her, please, and give her some time before you decide it.
And I think Clyde was saying that we would need to do this in a motion. I would suggest we have given people 90 days before.
Okay.
That's not unreasonable
okay.
of a time frame, but that there would be 30-day evaluations.
Okay.
And so the three need to see progress each
okay.
time.
Okay.
You know.
Okay. Do I hear a motion that we give her 90 days with increments of checking the progress on it every 30 days?
Motion.
Second.
Second. Okay.
All
in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. How's that, Ms. Cox?
Thank you very much. And what we'll do is, as soon as me and my husband get started on it, I will, me or him, either one, will give you a call to let you know. That way you can, you know, you can come down there.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Jason, you're still up. Let's see. Let me get my stuff here. All righty. Ready for the high impact. Well, I guess I need to close the public hearing at this point. So at this point, we will close the public hearing and we will go to planning matters. And we already done. Actually, I should have closed it a while ago. The mobile home appeal is done, and now we're going to the planning board review of high-impact land use, including industries ordinance. I have asked that the planning board review this ordinance. This ordinance came from Allegheny County, and there's some things in there that I dislike. And I have asked them to review that, but at this time, I'll let Jason talk and let you know what we have proposed.
Okay. Madam Chair, Commissioners, you should have a memorandum in your packet along with a copy of the ordinance itself. And I hope that you all also received the message from Ms. Massey requested me to contact everybody regarding the ordinance and to put together maybe a list of things you all wanted individually us to look at. On December 30th, and I'm going to be very careful to get into too many specifics of this because it is still a tabled appeal, and I've been advised by our attorney that we don't want to do anything that could jeopardize that appeal or bias anybody on that. So, but on December 30th, the Planning Board considered an appeal under the High Impact Land Use Polluting Industries Ordinance with regards to a racetrack located down McRae Road. At the meeting, the Planning Board voted to table and request that the Board of Commissioners consider possible amendments to the ordinance to provide delineation of recreational and commercial use. Residents at that meeting requested notification when the issue would be brought before the Board of County Commissioners, and a notice of public meeting was sent to those property owners prior to the meeting on the 20th that was scheduled. Of course, it was rescheduled for due to the inclement weather. Within the ordinance, this would specifically affect the following sections. Section 2 definitions, and the current definition for drag strip or racetrack is a purpose-built facility for the conducting of human-operated races of human-operated machines. The example given in the ordinance were automobiles, go-karts, lawnmowers, or motorcycles. Among the options of amendment, and again, this is just staff throwing out ideas, is the possibility of exempting recreational use of land where no payment for services collected for the purpose of running go-karts, motorcycles, etc. Another option could be a waiver that is applied for where certain conditions or conditional use waiver are placed on the property owner with regards to collecting money and the adherence of other permits and ordinances, etc. Basically, that would be the equivalence of a conditional use permit in what people have in maybe in other counties and other jurisdictions.
Okay.
Typically, it's associated under a zoning ordinance, but it is a land use rule. In addition to this request, planning staff and legal staff recommend considering an amendment to the ordinance under Article 4, Section 1B. This specific section deals with the permitting requirements and requires an applicant to make the following certifications, and we have them here italicized. The high-impact land use polluting industry for which the permit is being requested will at all times comply with the applicable regulations and standards imposed under this ordinance. The applicant has not constructed, maintained, operated, or modified any high-impact land use polluting industry within Alamance County without the approval of the county. And number three, no permit issued to this to the applicant under this ordinance or under any successor ordinance hereto has ever been revoked. Considering that requirement, if somebody wants to construct or if they do construct in violation of the ordinance, even if they can meet all the other requirements, they can meet the acreage requirement, the setback requirement, the spacing requirement, everything else, the buffering, the fencing, they can meet all those requirements. They still, by the rules of the ordinance, cannot be issued that permit by the way this is written. So staff is recommending to put in a provision that allows the owner to obtain proper permitting and to bring the property into compliance within a time frame of 30 days. And of course, that could be adjusted based on the planning board. What they suggest, they may go 45, they may go 90 days. I really don't know, but we're starting with 30 is what we proposed. And this is basically in those situations where people honestly do something in ignorance of the law. To give them the option to be able to bring it into compliance.
It's on page 11. If y'all want to look it up.
And under the amendment procedures of the ordinance, the planning board must be given a 45-day period to review any amendments to the ordinance. This request is not to amend the ordinance tonight, but to direct the planning board to consider specific amendments and other options. Should you all grant me the request, On the 20th, I had planned on calling a special meeting. At this point, we probably would just make it the next business meeting of the planning board. But we would make this as quickly as possible. And if it is something that the board wants to do, I would also make the recommendation to you all to go ahead and set a public hearing for in the future, maybe two meetings from now or something along those lines. Of course, that can always be adjusted if we need to do that.
Okay. Does that give you enough time, you think,
to figure it out?
Yeah, I think I think we could put together some amendments within that time frame.
I think we better wait and see what the planning board has to say.
Yeah, and then we can set that.
Do you guys have any amendments or anything? Have you read it? I've read it verbatim. And does anybody? I have one that I don't like. I don't think anybody. I mean, the thing about that I dislike is when you put a little backyard racetrack in the same category as a speedway, which has to have 40 acres of land. And, you know, I don't have but an acre and a third, and I could put a go-kart track on my property if I wanted to. So I really think that is a little bit too strong there for somebody that's going to have a, you know, as long as it's not a business and as long as it's just, you know, and if it's a noise situation, they can put a muffler on a go-kart, you know. May not run as fast, but nobody will run as fast, you know. So, I mean, it's fair all the way around if it has to be a noise ordinance. But I really think that 40 acres to put a go-kart track or whatever, now they're wanting to put an ATV track somewhere in the county, you know. So it's not much difference in that.
That could be. Excuse me, I'm sorry.
That's all right. It's not much difference in that as far as I'm concerned, but I really think that, I mean, you know, 10 acres, is there's something in here on a 10-acre track that you have to have. But I think for a home-based go-kart track is not, you know, if they don't charge for anybody and they just come for recreation, then I think we need something in there that addresses recreation. I mean, it may be like somebody's got a horse track around their house or something, and it's the same scenario, you know?
And that's conditional use.
Yeah.
Conditional use permit.
And that's what I was going to say. Staff, me, from my standpoint, I really lean towards that. Now, of course, the planning board may not agree with that, and ultimately, you all may not agree with that. But I think something along those lines, the argument that you hear from other people that are opposed to these things is that there's still other issues, that the dust and the noise and things like that. But with a conditional use permit, which Claude and I have talked about briefly, the legality of that, if it can be done, that would be something that you could put a condition on. Say, okay, that's fine. You can't meet the ordinance requirements, but we're going to grant you a waiver similar to the subdivision order. Mm-hmm. And but you've got to put mufflers on these. You can't collect money for services. You can't sell concessions, things like that. And you know, and you're going to set your hours, and you know, won't run them after 6 o'clock at night. I'm just throwing some hypothetical things out there.
Right.
But those are.
I think that's something
that
maybe people could live with. You know, I mean, because we can't tell everybody exactly what to do in there. You know, but I think that, if you've got somebody that's complained about it, you know, that's my thoughts on it. And I'll open it up. Anybody else got any thoughts about this? Anything in this ordinance? I have read this thing twice.
Ordinance. I heard a comment that, and I'm not sure who it was. It may have been, Mr. Childers. I believe.
Childers.
Whoops, excuse me. If you're watching, said something about insurance, and I think we had discussed it where the gentleman, is this yours?
Mr. Squires.
Mr. Squires, do you have these people when they come out there sign some kind of release, a waiver, so that if anything happens that you're not held responsible, which is a good thing.
Yeah, that would have to be put in there, actually.
Right.
Do not charge for the people coming on to see it. You know, anybody can come, and no charge. But the go-karts, sometimes, you know, a water track, stuff like that, and scrape it, they give $5 for the go-kart itself to run around the track. That's all.
Well,
I just think this is wonderful that you have done this. I've ridden by there, I've checked it out.
It keeps the kids occupied and off the streets and getting in trouble, and they're, you know, something that's recreational, and I do commend you for it.
When they're growing up like that, they're going to stay away from it.
That's right.
My fault.
Any other comments?
How many of you were on the board when we approved this ordinance?
Not me.
Were you on the board? You know, I'm going to be honest about the ordinance itself. The ordinance itself was rushed out in regards to an issue that was being proposed in the southern part of the county.
Yep.
Just be blunt about it and honest about it.
Well, it was a cement factory that was going to be built in the southern part of the county, and they brought this ordinance in to keep it from coming.
Paving company.
Is that not right?
Paving.
Basically.
Paving company.
Well, I can only speak to so much on that because I was the planner at the time, but when it went to the second reading, I was the interim planning director at that point.
Okay.
So, and I voted for it, I'll be honest about it, but I think when we voted for it, I mean, I don't think there's any question that the commissioners, somebody did, because I remember we asked about, could we review? I mean, could we waive something? And the answer was yes. And, you know, no offense to Clyde, but I saw a comment in the paper that he made about, well, if you waive one, you got to waive them all. Well, that's, I don't understand that logic. But
that was the planning board.
Huh?
The planning board does not have the authority to waive. Okay. Only the commissioners can waive them.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I don't remember the context of it.
Well, if we get it changed to be more common sense.
But I didn't think that when we passed this that we were going to beat everybody over the head with it. When every little thing came along. Now, I rode out there on a Sunday and met Mr. Squires at the track. And, I thought it was not out of character for the rural environment out there. It sits, 150 yards off the road?
Yeah, I'd say at least.
Yeah, and it's got good buffer trees, and he's got a tremendous amount of property going facing the road that way, and just relatively that way, and nothing but trees behind him that I could see. But the thing with me is high impact. The definition of the ordinance is just that, high impact. What is a high impact out there?
Well, under the ordinance, it specifies anything that produces a certain amount of, it's vague about it, a certain amount of dust or noise or pollution. And specifically under the definition of a racetrack, it doesn't define how many cars can run or how many go-karts or... It's very loose. It's open to interpretation for anybody, really. And that's where kind of the issue is. And that's the question that's so many people at that planning board meeting addressed to me. And honestly, I could not answer the question. And the question was, and it comes right down to, when does a couple people playing in their yard on a track become a commercial venture? When does it become that? When does recreation cease to be, you know, purely having fun? And that, under this ordinance, being that it is as vague as it is, it's not very specific on that, but yet it's very, you have to take a very strict interpretation of it. And that's where I think, again, the idea of conditional use or something along those lines, it puts a little bit of flexibility into allowing the planning department to work with that property owner and with the other citizens. And one of the things, not to labor on this issue, my job as a planner, as it was explained to me under the first planning director I ever worked for in Rockingham County, your job is not to think about the person that's right in front of you with the request. Your job is to think about everybody around them as well. And that's where it becomes the issue, is I have to try to work with them to do what they want and to do it reasonably, but also to take consideration to the neighboring property owners as well. And I think by having some kind of flexibility in there like that, that gives me the ability to do that.
I don't personally know Mr. Squires. I don't know that I've ever met him. I do know Gina. But I just feel like whether it's him or anybody else, that we need to be fair.
mm-hmm. about what we do. And for somebody to have, he's got 39 acres, is my understanding. And, you know, I mean, you can put an airport on 39 acres.
Right down the street.
Yeah, right across the road. Yeah. So I just think that it's a little unfair, and I think it needs to be looked at.
Yeah, okay? You come up with a special use permit where.
Conditional.
Yeah, conditional where everybody's happy, and that's what we need.
Do I need a motion on that?
Madam Chair, before you do it, can I get some clarification? May we get the planning board to rewrite this Romanette 2?
Yes.
That's the one that says if somebody like Mr. Squires goes out and builds something, and he comes back and says, let me do it the right way.
Right.
You can never do it. I think that needs to go out.
Yeah, it does. And also if it's ever been revoked. I think if they can come into compliance, is what you're saying.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if they can eventually come into compliance, then they need to be able to get a permit. I think so, too.
Okay.
Another thing, in reference to this ordinance, and we talked about it, the ordinance explicitly says it will not deter any form of agriculture, yet when you look on page 1, under regulated land uses, at the very bottom, it says swine farm.
I know.
And that's
we discussed this thing. I was in on all this stuff when I was going on. And this was a very contentious thing. And
It's really deep. I read it twice.
If you send this back to the committee, I think you need to go ahead and remove that because, first place, there's not going to be any swine farms going to be produced because it's a mom farm across the whole state of North Carolina.
Yeah.
But you're contradicting that. And I didn't realize that was still in there until I went over in the packet and read over the scene. And I called Mr. Engel and told him.
When you look at the size, Henry, of the swine farms, we won't have an operation that size in Alamance County. I'll assure you that. Now, you don't see many down east that size.
Okay, I need a motion to send this back to the planning board.
Yeah.
This time I'll entertain a motion to send this back to the planning board for review.
I will make that motion.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Gotcha.
Thank you.
And we will let you know. I don't know how many days are we, is that 45 days at that point?
It will be probably at least that, I would think. But the planning board has to have 45 days to review it. They may settle everything in one night.
Okay.
So we'll see. Yes, sir.
What in this planning? I mean, what have I got to change? I mean, you come off the top of your head with what I got to do.
They're talking about if there's a conditional use or something like that put into place?
Mm-hmm.
I think at this point, it's premature to even enter into that. At this point, we need to worry about getting something in the ordinance.
Yeah.
The conditional use would be you would present what your plans are to the planning board, and then it would come for review and try to work within that conditional use.
You said that's 45 days. Will you come up with something? And then another 30 days before they come up with something? How long?
Well, they would have to set a public hearing at a meeting before the public hearing. They actually have to set one first. In order to amend the ordinance, probably would be by March, if I were guessing.
Is there any way we can ride?
He can run or not?
Is there any way we can ride till then?
Just abolish that.
I mean, go away with the ordinance.
Well, we can't do that.
We can't. We need to work on it. That's
right.
I know you can't.
Yeah,
I want to do it right. I know.
And this will give you the opportunity to do it.
Yeah, and we really
give you a chance.
So far, I don't know what I got to do.
Well, that's part of what we'll work with.
Yeah, that's what we're
going to
do.
Jason,
but we're also not moving forward with any enforcement right now. I mean, obviously, the cease and desist letter still stands until this is all settled. But I'm not moving forward with enforcement and starting to tax, you know, fines and everything on it.
Yeah, you won't be fine.
No difference, because I ain't going to do it if you tell me not. If you tell me not,
I'm
not going to do it till we get it straight.
But I know, I feel like I'm belaboring this point, but at what point can we say it don't qualify for high impact? It doesn't qualify to be included in that ordinance review. I mean, it's almost like there's an automatic assumption that it's going to be in the ordinance. That's what bothers me about, you know.
When is the next planning board meeting?
Sorry.
Third.
Well,
what makes it high impact?
Based on
this ordinance,
right?
The ordinance, the way it's written,
the definition of the ordinance.
Yeah, it's totally opposite of the high impact land use ordinance. Can I ask a question, please?
Sure.
Running wrap all my life, then run across the road beside the wood. There are tracks, there are dirt lots showing mom and daddy's property about as close as that wall right there. How come? And they out there now, they the ones that's out there 7 days a week. Their deal is, we work on dirt bikes, we're going to test them out here. That's fine. How come that's not listed as high impact? And how come they don't have to keep their track wet, but Ralph does?
Well, I can't answer those questions. I think Mr. Martin can answer them, and we do know that.
Since we started with the go-kart track issue, I have had a complaint on that, and actually I was out on the property today investigating that. Okay. So.
Did you see them riding today?
No, they didn't ride today.
Yes, they did. Yes, they
not
did.
When I was out there.
I was out there
at roughly 4 o'clock.
And that's another issue. That will be addressed.
We're going to be here at 12 o'clock.
Okay, one at a time now. Come on.
That's right.
That will be addressed as well in the ordinance, okay?
Well, I mean, if they can get a permit and say they work on dirt bikes,
they may have to.
Let's keep our comments. Let me address you, please, okay? At one at a time. That is addressed, by the way. We have had a complaint on that, and we are checking on it, okay? How about that?
But they still ride.
Well, we just now got it.
You got then.
We just got the complaint last week. Is that right?
We got the complaint maybe a little bit longer than a week.
A little bit longer, yeah.
But they contacted me last week, and we had to reschedule a time to meet.
Okay.
But, yeah.
But just keep checking on that. Okay. It is addressed. Okay. Moving right along is the next thing is the emergency medical service billing contract, Mr. Chuck Mancellus.
Hey, Chuck. Madam Chair, Commissioners, thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. I have before you a contract renewal request for the billing and collections of EMS services by EMS Source out of Greensboro.
Okay.
This contract was initially entered into last January by then County Manager David Smith for a one-year term. The 1 year is up now, and it's before you for renewal, if you so choose. After it was initially submitted to you in your packet, County Attorney reviewed it and suggested a couple of addendums to that contract, which Clyde, help me out here because I'm going off the top of my head. It did not automatically renew annually. He gave us a 30-day escape clause if we decided we didn't want to pursue the contract, and it also established Alamance County as a venue in case we ever had a disagreement we need to go to court about anything.
That's correct.
The contract itself, EMS Source conducts all aspects of billing and collections. In return, they receive 10% of cash money that they collect on our behalf. I've got two folks from EMS Source here with me tonight. I'll be glad to take any questions that you might have, and if I can't answer them, I'm sure they can.
Are these for that people that just don't pay you, and then this just goes out for questions?
No, this is billing and collections across the board.
Across the board?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I wasn't sure about all that.
What happens is if...
There was a lot of money here.
What happens is if EMS Source gets to a point where they don't feel that they can collect it, then they'll return it to us. And then we will go through the debt set off or garnishment to collect those funds.
Okay. Any other questions?
No. I'd like to ask a question here. I was pleased to see some figures that they presented when we met. Ann and I met with Chuck and who else? Logan.
Shelly and Steve.
Yeah. The thing that really impressed me was the what we had been collecting or showing as a receivable. Versus what we're at now, we're showing 7 million versus the 4, right? Okay, and my question then, and you, I think the answer was yes. And I want to make sure I'm hearing it again. You feel like you'll get 7 million more? I mean, 7 million the second year, right?
Billing 7 million, yes, sir.
Okay, right. Now, because I didn't want that to be just a one-time deal. And I did ask the question, and you explained it, and I'd like for you to comment on it again, if you don't mind, for my information. What were we missing? I mean, 4 to 7, that's a pretty big increase.
The way in which things are billed is actually knowing the business and what the Medicare regulations are and different commercial insurance regulations are, and billing within those guidelines. And that is what we are doing. And we're continually not only training our staff, but continually training the paramedics and EMTs, so you are getting the most out of the billing. That is definitely what makes the difference.
We're missing a bunch. I feel like you get 7 in receipt, because I don't think it's going to be less people getting sick and less people wanting an ambulance. So
that is correct. You see that every year. I don't see people stop getting sick or getting in motor vehicle accidents or that type of thing.
Aging population with that.
That is correct.
Anything? Okay. Do I hear a motion that we
so move?
Accept this. Have a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Okay, the next thing we have is the budget amendment for the lottery proceeds.
This budget amendment number 87 is for the Alamance Burlington School System, and it's to budget state lottery proceeds from the North Carolina Education Lottery. This project will fund 4 classroom additions for Sylvan Elementary, and this is all state lottery proceeds. No county funds are involved.
That's great. Do I hear a motion we accept this amendment?
Second.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Motion carries. Okay, moving right along. Is the Assistant County Attorney, and Mr. Albright will address this.
Yes, I'm here tonight to ask for help. I went and looked over some of my facts and figures for the last year, and although I do look young and energetic, I am getting a little age on me. But I was surprised to learn about the amount of work that my department has done. Jamie Hamlet has assisted me with the child support part of it. I just want to give you some figures. I spent about 2.5 days a week when I do child support preparing for it. Jamie alternates with me. And I alternate with her when she has a conflict in juvenile court. But last year, we handled, between the two of us, 5,896 cases. We collected $10,077,745. $347,000 of those were collected in that courtroom right over there in purge payments. Dot Blanchard and I handled 32 tax foreclosure cases, which resulted in sales and payment of taxes. I've got numerous bankruptcy cases coming in every day. I've got 2 federal forfeiture cases in federal court where they don't want to pay the taxes, where they've seized personal property that drug dealers had. So I have filed motions in federal court to handle those in Greensboro. Whenever I have a hearing in bankruptcy court, I have to go to Greensboro. We've got the Jordan Lake rules. I spent most of my day today working on that presentation before the legislature. County line issues coming up. There's just a lot of things going on. And then the day-to-day activities of reviewing contracts and responding to various department heads, EMS cases, doing things for Parks and Rec, handling leases and purchase of property. And then there's the sheriff.
He's not in here.
The sheriff always helps me whenever I need help. But there are some cases I have with the sheriff, one of which is the jail case, which has been we won in federal court. I handled most of that when I got here. Hit the ground running, but we won that case. It's, if they're going to file it, they've got to file it in Alamance County, in our court. I've got 2 forfeiture actions in district court right now for the sheriff. 2 gun permit cases coming up, and just got through handling a subpoena in Superior Court for the Sheriff's Department. The sheriff and I have talked about doing nuisance abatement actions for some of these mobile home parks where he has an inordinate amount of crime. Takes a lot of his time and resources in responding to calls. Chuck's department, EMS, has to respond to these calls. Jamie's people, DSS, have to respond to them when the children get put in foster care because the parents have knifed each other and in jail. You would not believe the amount of calls from this one particular mobile home park. But the sheriff has asked me to take a nuisance abatement action. Now, that's going to take a lot of time. So what I'm asking for, with all these things that are going on in this county, is authority to advertise and hire an assistant county attorney. Last year, we were budgeted for outside legal fees, $61,824. We've reduced that this year to $10,000 because we're doing more of it in-house. I believe if I'm able to do it, we're going to do it. I'm not going to hire an outside attorney to do an attorney's job, but I can do. I like to provide same-day service. I like to answer calls the same day, turn around as quick as I can. For the past 20 years, we've had two attorneys in this county. I've got the money in my budget to do it. But with all the things going on, and with all the things coming out of Raleigh with the Jordan Lake rules, and we're going to need some help. I'm going to need some help. I've started the Child Support Day Labor Program. That's going to take off. I think we're going to make some progress with that, further reducing the burden on the taxpayer when these people in child support court can find a job. And we've had some success with that. Our mobile home recycling program has sort of fallen on hard times since the price of metal dropped, but we look for that to pick up too. But having said all of that, I think we can justify the position, and I'd like your permission and authority to advertise for it.
Question. I think this is going to be for Amy. That that was two positions in our budget for this year, and that's still there, right?
That is correct. Yes.
So I'd like to make a motion that you do advertise.
Is there any discussion?
Yeah, I'd like to talk about it a little bit.
If you don't mind, hold it.
Okay.
What kind of salary range are you talking
about?
Yeah,
I was wondering.
I had talked to Amy and Sherry about that, and I think it's about 74 to 80 is the range. Now, I think I was hired at 74, 75. What I'd be looking for, somebody with a similar work ethic. I got here this morning at 7 o'clock. I'll get here tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock. I'd like to get my work done. I don't like things piling up. And I like to provide good service to my clients, and I consider you my clients. So I don't want anyone to say that it's stuck in the legal department waiting for a response. When the manager calls for advice, he gets an answer within a few minutes. The clerk's the same way.
So this is in your budget, right?
It is.
It's in the budget.
Budgeted. What percentage a week do you spend in court? It's got to be.
I was in court this morning. I didn't think I was going to have to be. That's something I didn't mention. I get called into court quite a bit. I would say, I don't know, maybe on a good week. Well, when I'm not in child support court, that's usually all day Friday. But on a good week, I'm there a couple of times. I know I'm there at calendar call because attorneys, they seem to like my company. They put me on the calendar almost every week for something.
So how many hours do you think you're spending?
In court?
Or in a week with Alamance County?
Well, I get here early, and I try to put in a good full 8 hours. Sometimes I put in a little more.
Okay.
Sometimes 10.
Sometimes take it home.
Sometimes I don't take lunch because we got to get some things done. Mm-hmm. But I can say other department heads will do the same for me, especially the sheriff's department. Whenever I need them, they are there. No questions asked.
I know I'm not going to be revered for this question, but I got to ask it. When David was county attorney and you did what you did.
Yes, sir.
What kind of legal stuff did David do?
It's a little late now, Tim.
Well, it's all right. It's a little late, but yeah.
Let me answer this way. He gave me assignments
never
to keep
too late.
He gave me assignments to keep me busy.
It's going to be diplomatic.
And he was my superior. And my better, and I still consider him my better legally because he's a fine lawyer and a former judge. I didn't
ask him what he was doing, to be honest with you. He was the manager and the attorney and the clerk. But I do know that he did give me direction. We talked about the federal lawsuit, which he was interested in very intensely, getting that resolved. And if I needed some guidance on some things, he'd sit with me and point me in the right direction. But I do know he reviewed all the contracts, because I didn't see any of that.
Okay. Motion. I don't have any comments.
I need anybody got any comments? Okay, we have a motion on the floor.
And I'll second that.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you.
Opposed?
No.
One no.
I think the salary level's too high, and you should be able to broker that out somewhat at a lower level somehow. I just can't go with it. Sorry.
Okay. Okay, the next is the commissioner's meeting room occupancy issue. Mr. Mayor.
Chairwoman, commissioners, received our little notice on our occupancy situation. We've offered you a couple of solutions. We're here tonight to find out which way you want to go, what you want to do. Obviously, we've had a problem through the years, and we've just kind of gone with it. We finally got a complaint, and we had the room posted, which you can see the sign is up in the back there, and we'll try to work with you. Tonight, we did pretty good. Right now, I've got my clicker. We're at 37 in the room, so we kind of keep, that's why we started the overflow over there. Mm-hmm. We had about 45 over there, 60, 50.
50 over there.
While we were staying at about 45 here. We try to keep the room at about 45 right now, so if somebody comes up to speak and you bring two or three, mm-hmm. we do not violate the occupancy code.
Okay. So you think this is a good plan to use the courtroom?
For right now, yes, ma'am. Right now. And, of course, if you remove your meetings, that's where our suggestions are to you regarding moving the daytime meeting to tonight. Nighttime, where we can have, if we have a problem with court, we cannot use that. If you have overflow, then we can't have that in the hallway. They're going to have to be downstairs or outside. Mm-hmm. So this is our occupancy problem.
Yeah, and we can't have them outdoors. So.
No, ma'am.
So we either move the meeting or find another meeting hot place.
That's in essence.
Okay. We need a discussion on this.
Well, you know, I think it's easier for folks at work to come to meetings at night anyhow. Yeah, I really do. To me, it'd make more sense to have both the meetings at night. One in the morning.
We're not trying to tell you how to do your meetings, but I think it's going to be easy for us to manage it also.
I'm in agreement with Dan on that. I would have no objections to night meetings.
Any more discussion down here? Having it not
dead in the water down here. So. Is that what you said?
No.
Madam Chair, if you do decide to move the morning meeting to a night, it's really a two-step process. Uh-huh. The first one would be next week's meeting, the one on February the 2nd. You'd have to move that one to reschedule for the night meeting at 7 o'clock. You would need to then adopt a resolution beginning with the March meeting. From there forward, that all the morning meetings, first Monday of the month, would then be moved to a night meeting at 7 o'clock. I do have a resolution here for you. It's very short that you would need to adopt in order to do that. But it would need to be a two-step process because you have to give a 10-day notice to permanently change the meeting. That's why you have to do this in a two-step process. Okay. Let me just hand you a copy of this resolution.
All right. Okay.
So what you're saying, Tim, is we can't change next meeting?
You can't just do that.
Okay, I'm sorry.
You can remove that meeting to a night, yeah. And then the resolution, if you adopt that,
right.
Then it would change the meetings beginning with the March 2nd meeting there forward. It would change all of those first Monday meetings to a night.
Would y'all like for me to read this? I can. You don't want me to read it?
No, that's good.
Okay. All this means is that we're going to change our morning meeting to a night meeting in order to be in compliance with the fire regulation, our fire.
And that would become effective March.
That would become effective at our March meetings, right?
That's correct. And then the other motion would be to move next week's meeting, February 2nd meeting, to a night meeting at 7 o'clock. That's correct.
Okay. All right. So do I hear a motion to move the next Monday's meeting to the night?
Motion.
Okay. Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed.
And the next would be the resolutions of change, all of the Monday meetings, Monday morning meetings, tonight.
I'll make a motion.
To adopt this resolution. Okay, have a motion and a second. All in favor? Okay. Took care of that. Thank you. And we have this out right here. Okay, the next thing is the interim county manager report.
No reports, Madam Chair.
No reports. Okay, the next is our consent agenda. Do I hear any questions on that?
Motion to approve.
Second. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? None. Okay. Any announcements? Oh, I do have one for you. I forgot, I do have one. There's the 2010 Census Partner Proclamation. Do I need to read this whole thing, Pat? And evidently what this is to place an emphasis on the 2010 Census and participate in events and initiatives that will raise overall awareness of the census. Mr. Martin, is that already happened?
No, it's tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Mr. Martin will be attending a grand opening in Greensboro for a new building and a new Census Bureau, which will be opening in Greensboro tomorrow. Okay? Otherwise, and that's what this is. So that's the only announcement that I have. Do I hear any other announcements?
No.
Not. Meeting is adjourned. I don't know.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of Commissioner meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.